So this morning, I'll be talking about technology and collaboration in the 21st century classroom. So in today's session, we will be looking at collaboration and what it looks like in the past and the present. Lalo na, I've been teaching for quite some time already, so it's already been a few years since I was a student. Then we'll look also at technology in today's classroom and technology and collaboration in action. So to start off this talk, I'd like to always start it off with a definition. So collaboration is basically defined as working jointly with other people in an intellectual manner or intellectual pursuit, the action of working with someone as well. So as students, I've always seen students working together, especially in projects. So when we talk about collaboration, it's important that it's not just one person who is working, but it is a group effort or an effort wherein everybody contributes in a group project or in a research paper. And in my school, it looks like this. So in my school, we always have professional development sessions wherein we talk about how we can further improve our lessons, how we can also look into the future and see what problems will come in. We also invite international speakers to look into what we're doing inside the classroom and to help us. On my students' side, you can see that they're always working together. I especially enjoy it when there's a lot of noise in the classroom. Some professors might not enjoy the noise, but for me, when people are talking and discussing inside the classroom, it means that they are learning, they're discussing, and the different skills that your teachers or your professors always tell you about, collaboration, critical thinking, research, these are the skills that I see inside my classroom. And now that technology is in it, it's very inspiring and also amazing to see my students do wonderful things. But before anything else, back in the day, collaboration was difficult because for you students, you already have your cell phones, you already have your laptops, you already have internet, 3G, LTE, all the time. But back in the day, collaboration was having to go home and log into Yahoo Messenger. Has anyone reached Yahoo Messenger? I know sir and ma'am. I think we know that very well. So before, messaging was quite complicated. So we would have to go home, log into our Yahoo Messenger, dati pa nga dial up pa, so it would take forever. And naging DSL, so medyo naging stable na yung internet. And so we had to use this. And it was okay already, especially when it comes to group projects, because you can talk about it, you can make your group chat, you can also send attachments as well. But besides that, there was also text messaging as a way for us to collaborate. So sometimes we would have to text overnight or during the day, and then we would have to ask each other, how do we do this, how do we do that? And it was very limiting. Apart from that, when it came to submission of paperwork, it was, you have to wait for the professor's feedback, and then you'd have to submit it again, and then you'd give feedback, and then you'd have to submit it again. So basically, when it came to collaboration and technology, it was very basic. You had to wait for hours just before you can get feedback. You had to wait for days so that you can see the comments, or you'd have to wait for days just to see your groupmates submit their own output. But with technology today, everything is now working simultaneously. So, when it comes to technology, I have identified three areas. We have technology, information, and learning. When we look at these three elements, the first one, technology. In the past, it was bulky, location-based, like the Yahoo Messenger, and it was limited. Especially, we had to always use a PC or a computer. MacBooks or iMacs were really expensive, so we had to make do with whatever, with a computer shop, so that we could work. When it came to information, information was only accessible through the library. I remember when I was a student in USP, I would always spend maybe 3 hours just looking for a book, just to find out that it only gives me like 2 or 3 sentences when I was hoping for a paragraph or a whole volume. At the same time, information was also limited to experts. We'd have to wait for our professors to give us that information. And then learning was always classroom-based. Learning was limited to the 4 walls of our classroom, and we would rarely have the opportunity to go out. Learning was also teacher-centered, so it was, you know, Professor Mo was the master of information inside the classroom. And it was always lecture-based. Right now, it's lecture-based, but if given the opportunity, I would have made it a more hands-on workshop or activity. But as we move on to the 21st century, and as technology becomes more personalized, technology becomes personal, mobile, and connected. Therefore, it helps us to access information easily. It gives us varied information, both fake news and real news. So as a teacher who loves to teach about technology, it's important that we learn how to differentiate between fake news and actual news. Information therefore becomes personalized as well, because we now have the capability to discern, to differentiate, and to understand what kind of information is coming to us. In today's world, we have Facebook, we have Twitter, we have so many social media sites that give us information, and we create our own meaning and understanding, therefore making it personalized. And when it comes to learning, it becomes student-centered, research-focused, and collaborative. Now, when we take all these three elements together, we are able to create a synergy of learning where in collaboration, technology help each other to achieve these different skills of accessibility, creativity, differentiation, or making our learning personalized, and really making sure that our own creative expression is seen, heard, and expressed. We would also have critical thinking, holistic and meaningful learning, and all of these different characteristics that now define what kind of classroom we should have and the kind of teaching that we also deserve. So moving forward, when we think about technology and when we think about how it's used in the classroom, I always like to go to Edutopia and to watch some videos as well, and really get inspiration on how technology can be used inside the classroom. So it's a beautiful video of how technology has helped students inside the classroom. When I first started teaching, I did not know how to use technology. I was aware of it, but I did not really use it because of the time that I had to think about how do I use this gadget, or also think about like how will other students be able to use this. But as I started teaching and as I started learning more about technology in the classroom, I became comfortable with it because I realized that in today's classroom, my students, most of which are probably your age also, their attention spans are very short. And for me to continue to talk for 1 hour or 1 hour and 30 minutes or 2 hours is not conducive for their learning because at the back of their head, I need to do something. I would like to check Facebook. May nag-like ba sa Instagram picture ko? And so with technology, I decided that maybe it's time to move the teaching away from me, wherein all of the information is centered on to me, and give it to you in your own hands. And so I started looking at different models of how we can use this wonderful and amazing gadget inside the classroom effectively. And so it led me to this idea called the flipped classroom. So outside the classroom, when you go home, your teacher will give you resources for you to read. It could be a video that you can watch on YouTube. It could be a Wikipedia entry, and then you can take it further by visiting more credible websites. And as you're doing this outside of the classroom, you are taking in information. Even the League of Legends or Clash of Clans games that you are playing, it already teaches you different strategies. For history, for example, you could already start learning, oh, I'm doing different strategies that I use to beat this opponent of mine in League of Legends, Clash of Clans, or PUBG, or Overwatch. So you already start seeing, okay, pwede pala, I could use this strategy to flank that enemy, or I could analyze the different behaviors of some of the players. And when you take it into the classroom, instead of having a lecture with your professor on the strategies of the Roman Empire in conquering Egypt, which is very boring, you can already talk about, Professor, ma'am, when I started playing Clash of Clans, this is what I learned. I learned that if I divided yung squad ko, we could eliminate the enemies better or more effectively. Or if we had harvested these resources faster, then we would have probably won, and etc. So inside the classroom, instead of a lecture base, you would have discussions, you would have experiments, you would have hands-on activities that would help you use the skills and concepts and apply it to your own learning, therefore creating a more diverse classroom. But besides the flipped classroom, there's also another classroom that I enjoy the most, and it's an inquiry-based classroom, wherein your questions will become the basis of how you're going to take control of your learning. So as you engage with different resources and with the different information, you're able to learn about different concepts and ideas, which lead you to engage in critical thinking, research, start creating different projects for your community, could be inside your classroom or even taking it outside further. And you could also express and create your own understanding in different ways and mediums. So instead of the traditional pen and paper or PowerPoint, you can create a website. You can create a poster out of an infographic using different applications also. And therefore leading us to commit to responsible action, where you know, our learning isn't just something that's inside the classroom, but we take it further. And having these different types of classrooms in mind, led me to reflect on how to use technology in the classroom effectively and responsibly. So the first part is always the process, which leads us to think about reflection and later on the product. When we talk about the process, this is the most important part because this is where you'll see that you are collaborating with your classmates. There is an exchange of ideas that happens. You're able to apply different thoughts, different concepts in different ways. Then we also have the planning. It's here that our collaboration turns into action because that's when we start using different applications to help us out in our planning. And later on, it will lead to the development of understanding. And because of this process, we are constantly reflecting on different ideas, different concepts as well. And so as we reflect, we look back at the process that we just went through and think about, how did we do this? What was effective? What wasn't effective? How can we further improve on it? And lastly, as we talk about the product, this is the time when we start using technology in action for us to be able to create an expression of what we've understood and what we've learned. So inside my classroom, I've used a lot of technology. I've used Google Classroom a lot. I've used Google Docs so that my students can collaborate and so that I would also know how my students are working and if there are people who are actually contributing to our research paper. I've used this application called Flipgrid, where my students would discuss with one another their different ideas. They would record themselves, therefore giving everybody a voice inside the classroom, especially the shy ones, the ones who don't like to recite. I'm now hearing their voices and what they have to say and share inside the classroom. Then this application is so abundant. I like using it because it gives me an opportunity of an interactive whiteboard wherein students just post whatever their thoughts are, if they have any questions. And the best part is, unlike Flipgrid where your face is seen, this one is anonymous, so you can actually just write your question and your professor would be able to answer you. So there's already no judgment there. If you feel that you're going to be judged by your classmates or your professor, the technology now gives you that liberty to post things on anonymously. And so this year, I decided to take it further by allowing my students to use technology more because I was handling a class wherein we had to learn about science investigation and design thinking. So using these two models, I applied how technology can help make their science fair projects into a reality. So we started out our class by investigating different ways on how we can solve different problems inside the classroom. I had my students research different resources at their at home and also apply that inside their classroom. And so as they were working on this, they were exploring the world, they were documenting it, they were slowly building their prototype and start writing their research papers as well. So here you can see my student using her tablet to document her learning from the talk that she gave. And so it's because with technology that I'm able to capture all of these moments and share it with other people, because the stories that they have or the work that they're doing is a valuable tool in showing that, in showing their understanding. So instead of just putting all of your grades in a final paper or final research, it's this process that you see here, the way the students are working together, becomes a valuable source for me to grade your students. So if before we would always rely on the CER effort, grade for effort, now I have evidence to show that there is a grade for effort as well. And so just before I end this very quick talk, I'd like to end it with this video and a few more words.
I just got us a meeting with Vivian.
What? How?
I just bumped into her.
And what, you just asked for a meeting?
Yeah.
Is there anything I can do?
Actually?
When?
Just now.
No, when's the meeting?
Oh, Thursday, 8 a.m.
Next Thursday?
Yes.
No, this Thursday.
What?
That's impossible.
We can do this, okay? Roundbox is back.
It's just a sketch. That's all we have.
2 days? We need 2 weeks.
This is how we get off this floor.
Dave, can you get some sales figures on pizza boxes?
I feel sick.
It's so simple. Round pizza, round box.
Perfect.
Hey, who's hungry?
We have to prove what's wrong with pizza boxes.
You're square.
Wasted space.
Yeah.
Do I really have to go see Mike in finance?
Yep.
Hey, Mike. I was wondering if you could send me the thing.
Inbox.
We have this idea. We need some sort of 3D prototype.
I gotta pick up the kids.
I just want to get you all together. We need to find a name for the box.
Roundabout.
Squirkle?
Circle box?
Who's that?
Hey, Siri, turn on Do Not Disturb.
Brian?
I'm awake!
Hey, Siri, tell Bridget I'm running late.
No. This is wrong. This is all wrong.
Dave, can you please double-check those figures for us?
Did anyone hear from Ed in Warehouse?
He's putting together the prototype now.
What are you guys working on?
Nothing.
Nothing.
Move that over there.
Make that title bigger.
Guys!
We're almost there.
It all works. I mean, I don't even...
What are you doing, bud? Hey, can I have that back?
No!
I'll email you the video.
Just airdrop it to me.
Sweet. You guys, I just got the prototype. Whoa. This is gonna look so good in the presentation. Awesome.
Wow.
Uh-oh!
I'm awake.
It's time.
Did anyone press a button?
I really like that video because it takes what I'm doing inside the classroom into the workplace. So when you look at it and you think about technology, not just Apple, not just Google, not just Microsoft, but technology in general, it has the capability to really connect us to one another. It has the capability to help us create wonderful and amazing things that we never thought possible. But most of all, it is able to connect us to one another because each of us has different ideas. Each of us have wonderful thoughts. Each of us have different capabilities that would help build a workplace that is conducive for creativity and expression. Especially now that you're in college, you're in first year, as you go into the real world or when you graduate, the world that I work in will be totally different from the world that you will be working on or working in. And in the workplace, it's no longer about the GWA that you have, but it's about the creativity or the skills that you know, the research skills, the critical thinking skills, the collaboration skills, and the way that you interact with different people will become important in the future. So just to end, when we think about technology and collaboration inside the classroom, well done. We need to think about it critically. We can't just simply put in a computer and start working on different things. We have to really be purposeful and really think about it meaningfully. We also have to collaborate with a purpose. Each person has to have an important role in that group work. It cannot just be that person whom we know will be the summa cum laude of the batch working. It has to be everybody. It is a group effort. We have to make learning meaningful. Instead of always relying on our professors, we need to take the initiative and the action to make our learning our own. We have to be creative and expressive. And so with technology, with the Facebook, with Instagram, with Twitter, we are able to create wonderful ways of interacting, collaborating, and also sharing information that was never possible during our time. And we also have to think about the world and document it, because the world is changing. And in our hands is a technology that will be able to capture every single moment. And it is in these little moments that we are creating our own personal histories that we can share with two other people. And so I'd like to say thank you to everybody.